Heroes Among Us. First-hand accounts of combat from America's most decorated warriors in Iraq and Afghanistan. Edited and with an introduction by Major Chuck Larson. Foreword by General Tommy Franks. Afterword by Senator John McCain. Narrated by Lloyd James. Copyright 2008 by Major Chuck Larson. Foreword, copyright 2008, General Tommy Franks. Afterword, copyright 2008, Senator John McCain. This unabridged audiobook is published by arrangement with New American Library, a division of Penguin Group, USA, Incorporated, and was produced in the year 2008 by Tantor Media, Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. The following dedication appears in the book. For our fallen American warriors and their families, who made the ultimate sacrifice in the global war on terrorism. A note to the reader. In creating Heroes Among Us, I hope to produce a book that would help all of us better understand the experiences of the men and women who volunteered to serve in Iraq and Afghanistan. I also wanted to highlight a few incredible acts of heroism, so we might clearly understand and appreciate these soldiers' courage and sacrifice. To do this, I reviewed hundreds of military commendations for acts of valor in combat, and from those, selected ones that captured a range of voices and experiences. I then interviewed the combatants and asked them to tell their stories as they remember them, and in their own words. While these accounts are unvarnished and unfiltered, they have been edited for readability and coherence. I felt that first-hand accounts were imperative to the book's success. The soldiers' workmanlike attitude toward death, their inability to accept their own heroics, their superstitions, eerie sixth senses, premonitions, hunches, gut feelings, the surreal quality of events. These impressions cannot be conveyed by any method other than personal testimony. Through its personal nature, I believe the book also resists the pitfalls of overheated prose, of editorializing, of choosing sides. It does not defend or condemn the war. However, I believe it supports the troops through its presentation of recognizable Americans putting their lives in peril for their country. In two instances, first-person accounts were not possible. For the chapters on Medal of Honor recipients Paul Smith and Jason Dunham, both killed in action, I reviewed official accounts of their combat, interviewed military personnel who were there alongside them, and talked with family members. From these sources, I attempted to accurately portray both the individuals and the actions that led to their commendations. More women are currently serving in the United States Armed Forces than at any other time in our nation's history. While they serve at all levels of engagement in Iraq and Afghanistan, to my knowledge, only one has received the Silver Star. Attempts were made to interview her, but she declined. Foreword. What an honor it is to salute those who have earned our nation's highest awards for valor. For almost four decades, it's been my privilege to work with troops like those whose stories are told on the following pages. And I can tell you, if you wear a Silver Star, Distinguished Service Cross, Navy Cross, or the Medal of Honor on your chest, you have my respect. As you read the stories of Paul Smith and Jason Dunham, Brad Kasal and Louis Fonseca, Tony Pryor, and all these remarkable patriots, I think you'll agree. Major Chuck Larson has captured in these men's own words the actions, the deeds that raise them from warriors to heroes. All of us face curves in the road, but our troops face the life and death reality of roadside bombs, vehicle-borne explosions, and ambushes. Our young Marines, sailors, soldiers, and airmen are very good at what they do. They do their jobs, and they do their best to protect their battle buddies and innocent civilians. This book salutes their courage. Working in a world of uncertainty in the sun-blasted deserts of Iraq or the frigid mountains of Afghanistan, these soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines do their work with purpose and pride and without fanfare or grandstanding. They get the job done. They do it the right way. They deliver the goods. I admire them. I've always been proud of our country, but when I see those wearing our nation's uniform handle themselves in the chaos and complexity of war, it makes me doubly proud. From time to time, kind and well-meaning people call me a hero. I always tell them, I'm no hero, but I know a lot of them. This book is about a few of those heroes. Men and women who overcame their well-justified fears and rose above the call of duty. America stands today at an important crease in history. We are blessed by all that has gone before. Freedom and a way of life that permits us to dream the American dream. But we are perched on a razor's edge between this legacy, this past, and a future where fanaticism and tyranny carry the day. The fate of freedom rests on the shoulders of American patriots like those you are about to meet. I wouldn't want it any other way. General Tommy Franks. Introduction. This book is about heroes. It is about valor, honor, and sacrifice. But it is also about truth. And two facts emerge from the stories collected here. War is terrible, and war produces heroes. In fact, the worse the circumstances, the greater the heroics. The Americans honored in these pages come from all branches of the military and from all levels of specialization. From career soldiers of special forces to the Army and Marine reservists called away from their regular civilian lives. As the wars continue, new acts of heroism are being performed every day. This book brings to light a fraction of these acts and recognizes a few representative individuals from among the many. With the exception of the two Medal of Honor recipients, the soldiers profiled in this book have seen the face of battle and lived to tell their stories. But talking does not come easily for them. Most granted interviews reluctantly. The main challenge of the interviews lay in getting these soldiers to overcome their modesty and to talk about themselves. Their experiences range widely, but they share a few themes: humility, love for fellow soldiers, and love of country. We ask these men to tell their stories as they remember them, and in their own words. The word hero gets tossed around too easily. A major leaguer hits a home run in extra innings and he's dubbed a hero. A state senator votes the right way on issues of interest to educators, and he's called a hero. I've played baseball, and I've been a legislator. But it was only when I landed in Iraq that I knew I was in the company of heroes. This book is about them, the best of the best, the soldiers who are serving as the tip of the spear for our nation's defense. I've met with them and have listened in awe to their stories. I've been inspired by their bravery, struck by their humanity, and I have marveled at their humility. Over 1.5 million Americans have served in Iraq and Afghanistan in the past 4 years, and in every imaginable way they have sacrificed. Under the broiling sun, they've put up with sand in their eyes, grit in their teeth, and rocks in their boots. They have endured long stretches away from their homes and their loved ones. But only about 1 in every 20,000 have earned a Silver Star, Navy Cross, Air Force Cross, Distinguished Service Cross, or the Medal of Honor. Our nation's Silver Star is inscribed with the words, "For gallantry in action," and is awarded to those who conduct themselves with exceptional courage and marked distinction. The Silver Star is our nation's third highest military medal. The Distinguished Service Cross, our nation's second highest military decoration, is cast in bronze and overlaid with an American eagle. Established in 1919, it's awarded by the U.S. Army to a person who distinguishes himself or herself by extraordinary heroism while engaged in action against an enemy of the United States. The Navy Cross is awarded to a member of the United States Navy or Marine Corps for remarkable bravery, extraordinary heroism, and sacrifice in battle against an enemy of the United States. Equal to the Distinguished Service Cross, the Navy Cross features a sailing vessel centered on a cross. The U.S. Air Force awards the Air Force Cross, its own equivalent of the Navy Cross. The Medal of Honor is our nation's oldest, highest, and rarest military honor. The medal is presented by the President of the United States to those who risk their lives above and beyond the call of duty, performing deeds of consummate bravery and self-sacrifice. It's hard getting these medals. It's even harder getting the recipients to talk about themselves. But it's easy getting them to talk about their fellow soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines, the debt of gratitude they feel toward the leaders they respect and admire most, and their desire to be a part of a noble cause, a higher calling, or a larger purpose. They come from all walks of life, representing the entire spectrum of races and creeds. They come from America's biggest cities and from towns so small they don't even show up on the map. They are as different as they can be, but what unites them is their patriotic love for America and their willingness to sacrifice for others. Everyone in this book was willing to lay down his life for his comrades. In fact, some of them did. Living or dead, wounded or well, back home again or still serving in Iraq or Afghanistan, they're all heroes in my book. Ronald Reagan said that there are heroes among us if we just take the time to look. Every time I see an American in uniform, I see a hero. In 120 nations around the globe, 250,000 American men and women proudly wear our country's uniform and stand ready to defend freedom. More than half of them are in Iraq and Afghanistan. They are stationed in lands they have never before seen, fighting for people they have never met, and they do it in the name of freedom. That's another word that gets bandied about too cavalierly, freedom. Sometimes I think we use the word so often we forget what it truly means, or how valiantly America has fought to achieve that cherished destination called freedom. I know we take our freedom for granted. Freedom is our birthright. It isn't something that can be granted, and the desire for it can't be taken away. It's precious and priceless. Human beings are hardwired to want to make our own choices, to shape our lives and craft our destinies. From the day of this nation's birth, we've been the freest nation on the face of the earth. The moment we accepted this gift from God, we gave ourselves the mission of spreading liberty to the four corners of the earth and to the seven seas. Freedom is our number one export. Half of the world lives in freedom today, more than at any other point in history. But that's not good enough, is it? When everyone is free, it will change the world forever. As George Washington pointed out, when it begins to take root, liberty is a plant of rapid growth. I was in Iraq for a year where I served as the command judge advocate for the 372nd Engineer Group and the Task Force 185th Aviation Group. I advised the commanders of the two major units on all military legal issues. Although discipline and morale were very good, we had nearly 4,200 soldiers, Marines, and airmen, and as such, we confronted many of the same problems a small town of that size would face. I was fortunate to have Captain Doug Hoddle serve as my trial counsel. Doug, a successful Pittsburgh attorney, was one of the sharpest lawyers I have ever worked with. Staff Sergeant Andy Omberg, a Dubuque, Iowa native, was our trusted right hand in the office and helped ensure the success of all of our missions outside the wire. In addition to my JAG responsibilities, I also spearheaded our command's humanitarian mission. We built 12 new schools, 3 town halls, 2 new water treatment facilities, and we reestablished a veterinary clinic. Each building project was developed by the newly created city council in our area. For the people of this community, this was their first taste of democracy. Although at times the task was challenging, Iraqis were quick to embrace democracy, improve their community, and represent all citizens. As long as I live, I'll never forget the Iraqi children. They are sweet, beautiful, and smart. When I visited their schools, I noticed how desperately low on school supplies they were. To fill this tremendous need, our command started Operation Iraqi Hope. I sent an email to 15,000 Americans requesting pens and pencils, erasers and spiral notebooks. Americans have a spirit of generosity that stretches from coast to coast. We received more than 1,000 packages from 25 states, totaling over $100,000 in supplies. The children's shy smiles turned to squeals of delight. Each and every crayon or piece of paper was treated as a treasure. In all, we distributed 17,000 school kits. It's those kids' future we're fighting for. Helicopters serve as the modern-day workhorses of the war. The movement of troops, equipment, and resupply occurred 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. The demand on flight crews was great. As a result, our JAG office volunteered to be trained and to serve as door gunners on Black Hawk and Chinook helicopters. By day, Captain Hoddle and I worked as Army lawyers, and by night we flew door gunner missions across the country. Before returning to the United States, I had completed over 50 combat missions on a twin-rotored Chinook helicopter. My father, Charles Larson Sr., and I had overlapping tours in Iraq. He was the Justice Attaché, serving as the U.S. Department of Justice's senior advisor to Ambassador John Negroponte. His mission was to help build the new independent Iraqi criminal justice system. As we know in America, the foundation of democracy is the rule of law. Thus, it was a significant milestone when Iraq established the judiciary as a separate branch of government, with the rule of law as its pole star. His team also included U.S. Marshals, who worked to enhance security for Iraqi judges, and prison experts, who stood up the Iraqi prison system, focusing on enforcement of human rights. Because of my work with the aviation group, we were able to catch an occasional half-hour helicopter ride to meet at the embassy or where I served in Balad. Although we were light on gifts, my father and I were fortunate to spend Christmas 2004 together in Baghdad. In June of 2005, my father returned to his duties as the U.S. Attorney for the Northern District of Iowa. When I was deployed to Iraq in February 2004, I was proud to go, but I was naive about the Iraqi people. I assumed they were different from me. They were Muslim, and I was Christian. I spoke English, and they spoke Arabic. I was familiar with our customs and culture, and theirs were alien to me. Deep down, I may have even thought of them as my enemy, but I quickly learned that nothing could be further from the truth. These are good, loving, and hospitable people. They're born entrepreneurs. Iraqi moms and dads are no different from American parents. They have great dreams for their sons and daughters, and they care deeply about good schools. They pray for peace, and they yearn for a better, safer, and freer life. There is the misconception that because the Iraqi people have lived under the thumb of tyranny for so long, the concept of freedom is alien to them, or worse, irrelevant. But Iraqis are freedom-loving people, and they put their lives on the line every day for democracy. When leaving Baghdad, after my tour of duty was up, I looked across the skyline of that magnificent city, and nearly every rooftop had a satellite dish. To me, that symbolized their hunger for information and their deep desire for connection to the larger world. Information is the great liberator of the Iraqi people. It's easy to forget how far Iraq has come, but it's important that we remember. Nearly 5 years ago, Saddam Hussein and his psychopathic sons, Uday and Kusay, lived like modern-day Egyptian pharaohs, while the vast majority of Iraqis lived in abject poverty and unrelenting fear. Nearly every Iraqi I talked to had a Saddam Hussein story. Each experience included chilling tales of arbitrary arrests, mass graves, rape rooms, or torture chambers. One Iraqi worker I spoke with showed me where government officials had burned 5 holes in his leg with a soldering iron as punishment for being 5 minutes late for work. My translator had 3 cousins and an uncle executed by the Hussein regime, victims of the mass arrests and killings that took place in the mainly Shiite town of Dajjal. Is it any wonder that terror gripped the people of Iraq? Life was luxurious for a favored few, but the vast majority of the people lived in poverty, torment, and fear. Perched in one of his gilded palaces, Saddam Hussein was unfazed by their misery and unmoved by their suffering. If this man wasn't evil, no one is. Iraq has one of the highest infant mortality rates in the world. Tuberculosis is rampant. In many areas, people get their water directly from the bacteria-contaminated Tigris River. While Saddam Hussein lived among more than 90 marble-encased palaces, Iraqi children often attended windowless, run-down schools made of mud, brick, and thatch. Teachers earned $3 per month. Today, they earn $280. Democracies don't wage war against one another. If you want to be inspired, watch what people do with their newfound freedom. It's the power of an unchained human spirit, and it's a sight to behold. Since time immemorial, the forces of good and evil have waged war against one another. From the concentration camps of Poland, to the killing fields of Cambodia, to the jungles of Uganda and the deserts of Sudan, the forces of evil have been cruel and ferocious killers. Yet freedom is inevitable, unstoppable, and irreversible. The God who gave us the ability to dream and the capacity to love gave us freedom. When peace replaces war and liberty replaces tyranny, the world will be a better place to live. In other words, in the battle between good and evil, despotism and democracy, bet on freedom every time. Major Chuck Larson, Des Moines, Iowa, 2008. An inscription from the Korean War Veterans Memorial. Our nation honors her sons and daughters who answered the call to defend a country they never knew and a people they never met. Face to Face in the Dark, Anthony Pryor, Master Sergeant, U.S. Army, 5th Special Forces Group, Toledo, Oregon. Silver Star, Kandahar, Afghanistan, January 23, 2002. It was frigid cold and the air was thin at 8,000 feet in the mountains of North Kandahar, Afghanistan, when Tony Pryor and his fellow Green Berets entered an Al-Qaeda compound looking for key leaders, maps, intelligence, and communications equipment. Pryor found himself alone in a 25-by-25-foot room. It was pitch black, and he was attacked from behind with a wooden beam that broke his collarbone and dislocated his shoulder. Originally, I'm from a small town near the ocean, Toledo, Oregon. It's God's country if God has webbed feet. 9 months of rain. I spent a lot of time in the woods as a kid, hunting, trapping, fishing, and all that. The first movie I saw was The Green Berets with John Wayne. I was a good student, straight A's in high school, but I didn't want to sit in a college classroom. I was tired of that. I was ready for something different. I got out of high school, spent some time in the woods, in the sawmills, commercial fishing. That was getting a little old. I was looking for some excitement, so I joined the Army. I believe Army life agreed with me, and I went about as far as I could go. I did everything I wanted to do, and went to every Army school that I wanted to go to, and some I didn't care to go to. Haiti, Somalia, Eritrea, Djibouti, UAE, Qatar, Bahrain, Saudi Arabia, Egypt, Kenya, Kuwait. All those were places I would never have seen if I'd stayed at home and majored in who knows what. I'm not trying to glamorize Army life because the places that soldiers go aren't the nice places. Particularly because of the Christian-Muslim separation, soldiers are hidden like a third cousin. Soldiers stay in bad places like prisons so that they are out of sight. Other countries may need our help, but they don't want anyone else to know we're there. The Army teaches you self-reliance and teamwork, and one contradicts the other. You learn to be independent, and that means achieving through your own ability and skills and having confidence in what you can do individually. Teamwork means achieving through a synergistic effect. One guy can do 20%. Three guys can do 100% because you have more security, more guns in the fight, more eyes on the target. You have more trust. The Army taught me to understand myself, my own strengths and weaknesses. Everybody has them. And when I go out on the range, I work on the things I'm not good at. Identifying weaknesses and working on them yourself, that's a big deal. I never want to be the one who lets my team or my country down. Second place in this business is a body bag. As a leader, I don't want my guys in the bags. That isn't something that sits right with me because I care about my men more than they'll ever know. Our 5th Group's responsibility was the Horn of Africa and the Middle East. Our group was a bunch of Type A personalities, and they were there to fight. That's what we trained for every minute. If we weren't fighting, we were cleaning up after a fight or planning the next one. Our living conditions in Afghanistan were rough. We lived in the mountains at 10,000 feet. We slept in our clothes on the ground around a small fire. We got a bottle of water and an MRE, meals ready to eat, a day. We were relying on the kindness of strangers, and we didn't get a lot of it. Our team's character was aggressive and professional. Al-Qaeda started it with the Twin Towers. We didn't hit them first. Like the Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor, 9/11 was another day that will live in infamy. When America is attacked first, when we're on the defensive first, we stay the course. We beat the Taliban in the middle of winter. We're in the right. With me, what you see is what you get. I'm direct. I won't sugarcoat it. If you're going to be thick-headed, you'd better be thick-skinned. I never follow behind my men. I led my men from the front, and I'm glad I did. God puts you in situations you can handle, and this one, I could handle. I'm not sure if other guys could have. I have a lot of respect for my men, and my men have a lot of respect for me. We're brothers, forever. Some of this may be classified, so I won't say the number of the raid. This was in Afghanistan in January 2002, and it was a raid on the suspected Al-Qaeda stronghold during Operation Enduring Freedom. It was our 4th combat mission of the war, a sensitive site exploitation of 2 compounds, suspected of harboring Taliban and Al-Qaeda terrorists in the mountains. There were women and children within the compound, so aerial bombardment was not an option. Our mission was to search for key leadership, communications equipment, weapons caches, maps, and other intelligence. It was a split company operation, and the other guys went in before us. They walked 10 to 15 kilometers at 10,000 feet altitude in 10-degree weather under cover of darkness to get near the target. They got there undetected, which is a big plus. We came in with 2 gun trucks. We brought bigger guns, and, you know, big guns are good. We landed, linked up on the ground, and got our guns up. We drove right through the middle of their town in the middle of the night. It was frigid. We saw goats, heard dogs barking and fires burning, but no people. Not a soul stuck his head out. As we got near the target, I did all of my last-minute checks. I had my pistol, my frags, my knife. I could find my charges. Here was my flashbang. I counted my men. making sure everything was good. There was a lot going through my head and a lot going on. As we got near the target, the AC-30 gunship reported that the enemy was moving around the roof of the compound. We were trying to drive up to it, but we ran out of road. The road got so bad we couldn't get in that way, so we dismounted and got right close to the target. The guys on the hill, the other half of the split squad, made the initial charge and they lit the way. Here we were out in the open, running, and one bad guy went squirting off to our right flank, and Scotty, my ASL leader, ran over and rolled him up and handcuffed him and handed him off. I got to the corner of the compound and I called out, "Jimmy, give me a banger." That's a flashbang grenade designed to disorient the enemy. Jimmy shoved a banger in, and when he chugged the banger, it was like we hit a hornet's nest with a baseball bat. Everybody just started opening up on us from everywhere. There were muzzle flashes coming from every frickin' direction. There was a guy about 4 or 5 meters away, so close I could look him in the eye, and I stitched him. I put 4 in him. Anyway, that guy died. There was another guy shooting at us. I was reaching to get a banger, and a guy came at me from out of the door that I was fixing to enter. I just threw the banger out into the center and away from my guys. I started to pick up heavier volume of fire, but I wasn't seeing it with my night vision goggles, my NVGs. I was getting it out of my actual vision. A guy came at me out of a doorway that was covered by a blanket. I couldn't see who it was. I couldn't tell whether he had a gun. I just started beating the crap out of him. I was hammer-fisting him down. I wasn't going to just shoot the blanket because it could have been a kid. I figured, nice time is over and we need to get out of this and get some cover now because this is getting really crappy and it's right out in the open. When the guy fell, I saw he was a man with an AK-47. Jimmy stitched him up and I went in the room. I thought Jimmy was right behind me, but his long gun went down and he was transitioning to his pistol. He was engaging a different threat. I went into the next room and ended up there alone. The enemies were sticking their guns out the window, trying to kill our other guys, who were entering the house like ducks in a row. I went down the line from left to right and started whacking them. There was so much going on outside, they didn't realize that I'd come in. They didn't have any electricity, no NVGs, and it was really dark. I shot those guys. I was getting pretty deep into this magazine, and I needed to change mags real quick. While I was doing that, I could feel someone coming up behind me. I thought it was one of my guys, but it wasn't. This enemy guy whopped me on the shoulder with something, maybe it was a wooden beam, and crumpled me down. I got hit so hard that I saw white lights, floaters, bam! I got hit and went down to one knee. The guy jumped on my back and tore off my NVGs. He was kneeing me in the back and started to get his stinking little fingers clawing in my eyeballs. I reached up with my right hand. He was a pretty big boy with a beard and a ponytail. And I got him by the back of his head and flipped him over. When I did, my elbow hit the ground and put my dislocated shoulder back in its socket. Now we were face to face in the dark. The thing that really paid off for me was having done a lot of hand-to-hand combat training in gear. I fought a lot of guys with my full gear on. A lot of people will do combat training slick without gear. But you got to fight with your kit on to make it more realistic. It's a totally different animal when you have a rifle, pistol, shotgun, frags, bangs, smokes, and 85 pounds of lightweight gear on. You can't get away with all those amazing kung fu moves. They aren't in your arsenal. We were face to face and my left arm was raging and I thought, man, it's you or me, dude, and it ain't gonna be me. I want it more than you do. You're not gonna kill me. I got a life at home. My comrades got a life at home, and we're coming home. If this guy got past me, he could have shot my guys in the back. I went to biting on him. I could smell his sour breath. He was pulling around all my gear, and I was worried about him pulling a grenade pin or pulling one of my breech charges and blowing us both up. This had to end. I couldn't reach my rifle, pistol, or shotgun. My left arm wasn't working so well. I pulled him by the hair close to my body with my left hand, and with my right hand I shot put at his head. I broke his neck. I finished him off with a 9mm pistol. I holstered up and got my rifle and started looking for my NVGs. Then I heard the sound of an AK-47 going off and then the sound of metal bullets hitting concrete. I couldn't find my NVGs, so I broke a rule and went to white light. One of the guys that I shot decided he wasn't dead yet. He was getting up with a long gun, and I felt on the floor for my magazine and stuck it in there, racked up, and I beat him to the reload. I put two in him in a hurry, and he went to the ground. I went back to trying to find my NVGs, but I couldn't find them. The first guy I fought hand-to-hand must have unplugged my communication system. I couldn't get a hold of my A cell and B cell leaders. I thought for a moment, my guys aren't answering. Maybe we lost. I gathered up rifles and all the ammo. I was starting to come out the door. I didn't want to come out with an AK, because if my guys saw that, they might think I was the enemy. I couldn't tell what was what because I didn't have my NVGs. I got to the door and yelled, "Is there an eagle out here?" And Johnny yelled back, "Yeah, who is it?" I said, "Bucket." That was my nickname because the guy said I had a bucket-shaped head. "I ain't got my goggles. Give me a white light flash." He did, and I went over to him while yelling, "Tony coming in! Tony coming in! Tony coming in!" Johnny got my communications hooked back up. A lot of that stuff you can't reach yourself, and I got a hold of Scotty, Jimmy, Donnie, and Brady, and I knew everything was going to be good. There was still some shooting going on, battles within battles, on the ring and the east side. The guys back there were doing so much damn shooting, I thought one of our guys had to have been shot or killed, but we were all okay. Around the wood fire at base camp, I went around and had to touch each one of my guys. That was good for them and good for me. Everyone looked like they'd aged 10 years. Being in charge isn't all good because you really worry. These guys put your trust in me to do the right things to keep them alive. I didn't want to disappoint my guys, and I don't think I did. There were 21 enemy killed. No Americans killed or seriously wounded. It was a frickin' miracle. They were a bunch of good, hard-fighting dudes. Everything was stacked in our favor. It was meant to happen. We captured quite a few POWs. They had guns, but they weren't shooting at us, so they're alive and well. They didn't want to fight, and we didn't fire. Our guys did what they were supposed to do. I'm proud of them. They did a good job in that war. The whole company had KIAs and WIAs, but they kept rolling on. They kept doing what they were supposed to be doing. There are so many guys in that company who are heroes to me. Some things you're going to have remorse over and regret them. I think that's a positive thing because that lets you know you're still okay. When it's game time, lock and load and let's roll, let's get it on. But when it's all over, pulling kids out of buildings, you feel good about that. Handing things out to people, you feel good about that. I'd like to say I'm older and beat up, and I got a lot of things that hurt. I would like to change some things I didn't do in my personal life with my family. The first 24 years are for God and country. The next 20 plus have to be for the wife and kid. Life means a lot. And when you come close to losing it a few times, it becomes considerably more precious. 2,000 plus Americans have gotten killed in Iraq, and I'm sorry they had to get killed. That's a terrible loss. That was somebody's son, daughter, mom, dad, wife, or husband. Somewhere, somebody really loved that person. War is a bad thing. It's an ugly business, and people are going to die. It's a terrible thing for us to have to do. But hopefully our kids won't have to cope with it. Maybe people should at least keep us in their prayers. Tony Pryor is a Green Beret and has been with the Special Forces for 14 years. A mighty bull of a man at 5 feet 11 and 235 pounds, Tony bench presses more than twice his weight. He went into combat wearing a medallion of St. Michael, the patron saint of soldiers, duct taped to his dog tags. He suffered serious but non-life-threatening injuries on January 22, 2002, and earned the Silver Star on June 12, 2003. He keeps a chunk of his collarbone in a jar. He forbids toy guns in his home. Since this interview, Tony Pryor has returned to Afghanistan, once again working with his men in combat, what Tony describes as Shangri-La. Three decisions to die. Brad Kasal, 1st Sergeant, U.S. Marine Corps. Afton, Iowa. Navy Cross, Fallujah, Iraq, November 13, 2004. Brad Kasal has spent 22 of his 40 years in the Marine Corps. He brings a wrestler's tenacity and a middle linebacker's instincts to the battlefield. He saved the life of a fellow Marine in Operation Phantom Fury, America's assault on the insurgent stronghold of Fallujah called Queens. On that day, he says, I did what I had to do because it was the right thing to do. Kasal was recently promoted to Sergeant Major and was awarded our nation's second highest medal, the Navy Cross. By eighth grade, I knew I would join the Marines. It's what I had wanted to do forever. If I'm going to do something, I'm going to do whatever's the hardest. Boot camp was in San Diego. It wasn't that challenging physically because I'd wrestled and played football at East Union High School and I was in pretty good shape. Mentally, it was more challenging because I was away from home and the Marine lifestyle is so rigid. The first day was a shock. The senior drill instructor was a very good man who was stern but fair. He took care of us well. The junior drill instructors spent the most time with us training and teaching. One guy didn't teach us anything. He just yelled at us. I was the high shooter on the range, high physical fitness test score. I was doing well. I knew how to shoot already from hunting pheasant back home in Iowa with an old hand-me-down 20-gauge shotgun. The Marine Corps really helped me realize my potential as a leader. I have the ability to motivate young Marines. Since I joined the Marines when I was 17 years old in 1984, I've served in too many countries to name. Somalia, Djibouti, Afghanistan, the Philippines, West Africa, 10 deployments in all. Our first deployment in Iraq lasted 5 months. Then on May 23, 2003, we went home. In June 2004, I volunteered to stay on and go back. I was supposed to get orders to go somewhere else, but I wanted to go back to Iraq. I've been in the infantry for 20 years, and I have experience. I volunteered to go back because it was my duty, and I believe in what we're doing over there. I've done other combat tours, but in my 20 years in the military, this is the most important. I believe in the mission. We were in constant, almost daily action. We went to the outskirts of Fallujah, which was a hotbed, and we were always hitting the area, looking for the enemy, always engaging, very active. Search and destroy the enemy. These were foreign fighters, and they were there to kill Americans. They didn't care if local children got killed. They were fanatics, well-trained, well-determined, and equipped with night vision goggles. They were from Syria, Egypt, Afghanistan, Chechnya, and Jordan. For 3 months, all our activities were focused on the south side of Fallujah. It was a deception operation because when the heart of Fallujah was attacked, it was attacked from the north. I was wounded in August 2004 in one of those operations. I was hit by shrapnel in the neck and shoulder. I gutted it out. I kept going, like a lot of Marines do. We were going strong, day in and day out, until the night of November 12th, when we got our first decent night's sleep in a long time. We woke up in the morning and it was cool and eerie. There was a sewer-like smell in the air. We started out at dawn. Our orders were to clear every building, house, and street. We found out to try to clear that portion of the city we called Queens. Around 10:30 a.m., I saw Sergeant Pruitt, one of my former Marines in Kilo Company, walking down the street in the opposite direction from me. He was bleeding from the arm and leg and not carrying a weapon. He staggered aimlessly in a daze. I ran out, grabbed him, and pulled him between two buildings for cover. I asked him what happened, and he said three other Marines had been inside this two-story stucco and brick house a couple of houses ahead of us. The four of them had gone into this house, and all hell broke loose. All of them were wounded. Three Marines were still inside. He said it was like the shootout at the OK Corral. He didn't know how severe their wounds were or what their status was. He did know they were still inside that house with the bad guys. My first thought was Marines down inside the building with fanatical insurgents who would behead them or torture them or shoot them right on the spot. Time was of the essence, and I immediately grabbed whatever Marines I could find. Four of us headed toward that house. I ran into Corporal Mitchell, a squad leader from Kilo Company, and he was doing the same thing I was, gathering up Marines. Since it was his squad, I didn't want to overstep him, even though I was senior and held a higher rank. I just said, "You take over, and I'll help out because you need bodies." We went to the side of the building and set up a stack to make an entrance into the building. We went through the front door. I was the third person in. Inside the room, I immediately noticed two dead guys, insurgents, on the ground and another one in an adjacent room. I saw the friendlies, who were wounded, bleeding in the middle of the floor. I walked in, and there was a stairwell to the right, and then three adjacent rooms, two straight ahead and one small room off to the left corner. Our Marines found out, and everybody went to those two rooms. We forgot about the third small room to the left corner. I yelled to the Marines, "Hey, did anybody clear that room? Did anybody clear that room?" No one answered. No one knew. I grabbed PFC Nickel because he's a fearless Marine I would always trust. I said that it was a danger area, and I said, "Hey, come with me. We got to clear this room." As I moved up to the room, I thought about our rear. I yelled to two Marines, "Cover our rear and make sure you cover that ladder well." They set up, and I went into that small room. I started pieing the doorway, which means to clear a little bit of the room at a time so you can see more and more of it without exposing yourself completely. To my left, less than 2 feet away, close enough that I could have shaken hands with him, was an enemy soldier with an AK-47 pointed right at me. I saw him, and he saw me. I shouted, "Bad guy!" His AK-47 was inches from me. He screamed something in Arabic, and I jerked back. He fired off a burst. A round skipped right in front of my chest and hit the side of the wall next to me. He just kept firing. I took my M16, stuck it over the top of his AK-47, put my barrel literally in his chest, and kept firing until he went down. I shot 8 or 10 rounds into his chest at point-blank range before he fell. He was high on cocaine and other drugs, which was commonplace. This way they could withstand pain and sleep deprivation. They could take multiple hits without feeling the pain and keep fighting. He finally went down, and then, as he hit the floor, I put two more in his forehead just to make sure. I said to Nickel, "That was a close one." I brought my weapon back up because I couldn't see deeper into that room. It was dark. No lights, no windows. Just as I did that, I started worrying about our rear again because I didn't hear my Marines back there who was supposed to be covering it. I didn't want to look back because I was responsible for providing security to the front. I yelled back to the young Marines, "Hey, make sure you're watching our backs." Just as I got done saying that, out of the blue from behind me and above, all hell broke loose, with AKs opening up on me and Nickel hitting us from behind. I never saw it coming. I felt like someone was hitting me with a hammer on my right leg. My legs buckled out from underneath me and I collapsed to the ground. Rounds were hitting all around me. I heard Nickel go down. He was grimacing in pain, so I knew he'd been hit. I looked down at my leg and it was shattered, totally pointing in the opposite direction of my body. I crawled on my stomach to get behind the wall, to get into the room to get some cover. As I was crawling, I became aware of Nickel still stuck out there and getting shot at. I crawled back out to pull him to safety. As I did, the insurgents started shooting back at me again. Rounds were hitting all around, and and eventually one hit me in the buttocks area. I just kept going. I kept crawling until I reached Nickel. I grabbed him by the back of the body armor and dragged him across the floor while I was on my side, dragging first myself and then pulling him with my arms until we got around the door. Then I threw him over the top of me so I could get him on the far side. Now there was a wall between us and the enemy, but they were in the very next room. I looked at his wounds, and I looked at mine. We were both bleeding severely. I started treating Nickel's wounds. Blood was spurting out of my leg, and it was nearly cut in half. My first thought was, we have two field bandages between us, and we have multiple wounds. I had gunshot wounds to my lower extremities, lower back, and butt. He had gunshot wounds to his belly and legs. I made the decision right there to treat his wounds. I made three decisions that day to die. Not that I wanted to, but it was either both of us die or one of us die. That was my thought process. I put one dressing on his leg as a tourniquet to stop his leg from bleeding. I took the other one and tried to take off his body armor so I could treat his belly wound, but with me lying on my side because I was shot up and him lying on his back, it was hard for me to get his gear off. We were in this little 3x5 room. The dead guy that I had shot was at my feet. It was that cramped. My shattered leg was just lying there like a piece of sausage. As I tried to get Nickel's armor off to treat his wound, I kept thinking that the enemy on the other side wasn't going to settle with us being in here. I also worried about friendly fire. I took my M16 and laid it in the doorway so that if any friendlies came in, they'd see that and maybe pause before shooting up the room. I pulled out my 9mm pistol and used that as defense. Then I went back to trying to treat Nickel's wounds. I was bleeding pretty severely, but like I said, I made the decision to give up my bandage and use it to treat his wounds while I continued to bleed out. If I had put one on him and one on me, we'd both die. My adrenaline was flowing too high for me to black out. I kept yelling at Nickel to keep him conscious, even though it meant that the enemy knew we were still alive. I was worried that the enemy would try to skip rounds around the room or throw a grenade. No sooner did I start to think that than I heard a thud to my right, the sound of metal hitting concrete. I rolled over and saw a green pineapple grenade, its pin pulled, landing just beyond arm's reach. I didn't have time to roll over to my right and try to swat it back to the other room. The only thing I had time to do was roll over and protect Nickel with my body. I covered him up in a bear hug. People say it's heroic, but I thought I was going to die anyway, so why should both of us die? The blast went off and hit me all over the lower back, arms, and legs. I felt the sharpness and the pain like severe bee stings. My ears were ringing and I was pretty dazed. All the other things that come with a blast. It rang my bell pretty good. I shook my head and tried to clear the concussion. As soon as I did, I rolled back over and tried to treat Nickel's wounds, while keeping out an eye and an ear in case the enemy came in the doorway to finish us off. I heard some movement outside the door, so I took my 9mm and brought it up. It was Corporal Mitchell, the original squad leader. As he ran to our room, the bad guys started shooting at him. He took some shrapnel ricochet from an AK-47. He was stuck in the corner of the doorway. Then he was able to get into the room with us. He asked how we were doing. I told him not to worry about me. I said, just take care of Nickel. I put a tourniquet on his leg, but I couldn't get it real good, so you'll have to redo it. And he's got a hit somewhere in his chest or belly, but I can't get his gear off to see where it is. I'll cover the doorway. You take care of him. I was still pretty alert. I was lying on my side with my feet propped up on the dead insurgent. The whole time we were in the room, the dead insurgent was still twitching. That's how high on drugs he was. His nervous system was still going and his eyes were rolling around in his head. In fact, Corporal Mitchell thought he was still alive and stabbed him with his bayonet, but he was dead. I guarded the doorway while Mitchell gave first aid to Nickel. When Nickel was stabilized, we tried to figure out a way to get out of there. Then some more Marines came and set up in the doorway. They lay on their backs and shot up into the skylight where the enemy was, suppressing them while two young Marines came into the room to carry us out. They'd left their weapons behind to carry us, and those guys are the real heroes in my book. We had to go through the kill zone to get out. I put my arms around their shoulders and kept my 9mm in my right hand ready to shoot. They were able to keep the enemy suppressed enough that I didn't have to use my weapon. They pulled me across the room and out the front door, dropped me on the steps, and the Marines from outside grabbed me and pulled me into a Humvee with the rest of the wounded. We headed out of the city and went to the battalion aid station. The total time Nickel and I were in that room was over 60 minutes. I refused all medical attention so Nickel could get it. I refused all morphine because I wanted to keep a clear head. I never lost consciousness, although I lost 60% of my blood. I'll be honest, a couple of times I didn't think I was going to make it out. I thought I'd never see my family again because I was going to bleed to death. People think that it was a medical miracle, but it was either stay awake or die. The only thing keeping us alive was me staying awake and conscious to guard that door. I did what any Marine would do. At the battalion aid station, they gave me a couple of shots of morphine, put a splint on my leg, cut off all my gear, bandaged me up, put on a tourniquet. Then a helicopter flew me to a naval field hospital at Camp TQ, where they took me right into surgery. That was my first of many surgeries. I've had 20 surgeries and lots of rehab. I'm walking now, with a limp and a lot of pain. I'm using a cane, and it's getting there, but there will be a lot of pain and rehab yet to come. I'll never get my leg back to where it used to be. I'll never be 100%. Everything was shattered from about an inch below my knee to just above my ankle. The fact that I'm still alive is stunning to most people. I was shot 7 times and took 46 shrapnel wounds and lost 60% of my blood. It's a miracle to most people, but I'm a Kasal, and we're tough. The 66-day hospital stay was the worst. But if there was any hospital in the country I would choose to be at, Bethesda Naval Hospital would be the one. The nurses, doctors, and staff were phenomenal. The worst part was being away from my Marines for Thanksgiving, Christmas, and New Year's. It's a bond that's hard to explain. They're like a second family to me. President Bush came to visit. There was a big aura about him when he walked into the room. You could tell he was the President of the United States. The main thing I remember was that he showed good leadership, he showed sincerity, and he showed compassion. At the time, I had a roommate who was a junior Marine, but my bed was closest to the door when President Bush entered. He came in, and instead of going to my bed, he said, "I'll talk with you next, First Sergeant." He went to the junior Marine first, as he should. Then he came to me next. Not a lot of people would have known to do that. I could hear the sincerity in his voice and see it in his eyes. Also, he didn't have a big media circus. It was just a photographer and a close personal friend. That was it. No media, no security, no nothing. I'm going to will myself back to health. Just out of sheer willpower, I'll come back stronger. Retirement can wait. I want to serve in the Marine Corps for another couple of years. If anything, I love the Marine Corps more. I want to go out as I came in. Healthy and in uniform with pride. The day before Brad Kasal was promoted to Sergeant Major and awarded the Navy Cross, his father, with whom Brad shared a close relationship, passed away. Brad has since returned to Iowa, where he serves as the Sergeant Major of the Marine Recruiting Station. He is now walking without a cane and beginning to run again. "It wasn't pretty, but I was able to do it," he said. His goal is to get strong enough to return to the infantry and go back to Iraq. "We started it. We need to finish it. I believe in what we're doing. I'd go back in a heartbeat. The person beside you. Timothy Nein, Staff Sergeant, U.S. Army. 617th Military Police Company, Henryville, Indiana. Distinguished Service Cross, Baghdad, Iraq. March 2005. Southeast of Baghdad, 26 supply vehicles were ambushed by 50 insurgents armed with AK-47s, RPK rifles, rocket-propelled grenades, and hand grenades. Shadowing the convoy of mostly 18-wheelers were the 617th MPs and three armored Humvees. The squad leader, Staff Sergeant Nein, and his soldiers outflanked the enemy, cut off their escape route, fought off the enemy's massive firepower, plunged into a canal to take on the last insurgents, and disrupted the enemy ambush. 27 insurgents were killed, 6 wounded, 1 captured, and none escaped.
I'm 37 years old, and I've always lived in Clark County, Indiana. In civilian life, I was with International Paper Company for 15 years, working in the free press department, making the plates that went on the presses. The last couple of years, we went digital, and I worked with computers. I've been in the Kentucky Army National Guard since I joined in November 1996. I'm with the 223rd Military Police Company, which is about 20 miles south of where I live, across the border in Kentucky. I completed my basic training in June 1997 and was an honor graduate. I've been deployed to Bosnia, Panama, and Ecuador. I got called up to go to Iraq when the war started. I was a squad leader in charge of 9 other soldiers of the 223rd, and I guess you could say there was a little apprehension. But I was excited because this was what we trained for, and it was time to do our job for real. I remember being in Kuwait in 2003, getting ready to cross the border into Iraq, and I heard the alarm go off. There had been an enemy launch. We could see the incoming missile. We were all lined up in our suits, watching the Scud fly through the air. While we were watching it, getting our gas masks on and all, we saw it blow up. The scariest thing to me was taking cover inside the tents or the foxholes, thinking this could be chemical warfare.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.